In Kanojo Okurishimasu, aka Rent a Girlfriend, aka KanoKari, Chapter 239, the main love interest asks the protagonist if he's really fallen in love with her or with the image of herself that she creates for her job. For a story that takes, as its premise, a service where women act as a man's perfect girlfriend for a man for a fee, it is probably the most introspective the story has ever been about its characters. In this moment, the story acknowledges the psychological toll of romance under capitalism. The economic mode of production we all find ourselves subject to forces us into performance without end, to the point where even romance, an intimate and almost universal emotion, is rendered a commodity to be bought and sold on a market for profit. The chapter is the first time the story sheds light on the owning classes. Yeah. Nah, but could you imagine, like KanoKari being profound? Ah, that's funny. That's funny. Yeah, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Rent a Girlfriend is doo-doo. It's really, really bad. Holy shit. So, just to get everyone up to speed, Rent a Girlfriend is a manga that started serialization in 2017, but it only really rose to prominence in summer of 2020 with the release of the anime adaptation by the same name. Now, if it were 2020, I'd write a whole damn thing about how KanoKari is super sexist and the writing's terrible, and how it's only popular because there are too many damn incels who'd rather jack off to a pretty fictional girl than clean themselves up a bit and get on Tinder. It would be this whole thing about how everyone basically ignored the fact that the main character of this thing acts almost exactly like an abuser. How I've watched a show with people who have various experiences with abusive partners and how they've told me those experiences track with the show almost one-to-one. How people are mistaking a pretty girl with a spicy tude for an actual character with agency and personality. How the show is designed to make you think that progress is being made as it regurgitates the status quo again and again and again and again and again and again and again. But it is not 2020. It is 2022. Don't get me wrong. This essay will still hit a lot of those beats. As usual, I have a lot of things to say about stuff. But until now, for various reasons, I've sort of just sat back and watched the discussion unfold. People I know have tackled the show, like the joystick system, who I will always say got it first and got it right with their video. See, there was a time in late 2020 to early 2021 where saying Rent a Girlfriend is a bad show was a hot take. It was the hot new show. The most popular anime podcast around, Trash Taste, called it the best new anime in summer 2020, and the second best anime overall after the returning anime ReZero. The show's female lead, Ichinose Chizuru, was slated to be the best female character of the year, only missing out on the title in the 2020 Crunchyroll Awards because she competed against the legendary Kaguya Shinomiya from Love is War. I always figured the KanoKari essay would be an uphill battle. First, proving the story is not well written, then proving a lot of show's premises are false, then proving all the creepy shit and sexism that's there is actually there. But then, something magical happened. Something that pretty rarely happens in my very niche line of work in being a professional political anime hater. People, it seems, collectively changed their minds about KanoKari. It all came to a head, and I'll be blunt about it, so spoilers, with the release of Chapter 218 in late 2021. This chapter... it's pretty funny. Okay, this essay is already late. I'm sorry, I'll focus. In this chapter, the protagonist gets a flood. we're fucking keeping this as an outtake. Okay, let me actually focus. In this chapter, the protagonist gets shown in a full-page spread, crying, underwater, fully erect. You can see his entire penis bulge, okay? Full mass at the thought of being cuckolded by some hot guy. By the way, just for the record, right? I think that the real kicker here was the 8 pages prior of uninterrupted sex scenes that this dude is just imagining. I have to stress this. No one is actually getting laid here. He's literally imagining it. The hot guy he's fantasizing about cuckolding him while getting hard in public is wearing a beret, and for none of those 8 excruciating pages does that beret ever come off. Personally, the fact that the beret stays on during sex is what did it for me. That took it over the edge. People lost their goddamn minds over this chapter. There were memes. Oh my god, the memes were fire. People who defended the show for 2 years had to come out like, oh, I disavow. Dudes literally apologized for recommending KanoKari. People will apparently excuse the protagonist stalking his crush, I mean, literally following her around unnoticed for 6 straight hours, but then draw the line at cuckoldry. I will remind the observant viewer that only one of these 2 things is illegal. Everyone hates this manga now. Every other day now, there's a video essay about how KanoKari is bad. Even the Zoomers are getting in on it. Every once in a while, I'll see like an anti-KanoKari TikTok, which is crazy. This puts me in a bind. After all, I thrive off being a contrarian. People are usually like, oh, this thing is good. And I go, no, it's bad, it's racist, stop. It's a fun little game. It's been working for me. But this is peak KanoKari hate them fever season. Everyone who's anyone cool hates KanoKari. And as much as it'd be fun to sit here and argue that this piece of media that everyone hates is actually good, if you'd like to see me do that, by the way, check out my High Guardian Spy Stick. I simply can't. I agree. KanoKari is shit. It's bad out here. So yeah, I'll talk about why the show's bad. This was supposed to be a short thing, but that's actually harder to write than something long here. I'll talk about the political implications, I'll do all the sexism. But I also want to take some time to explain myself. See, if you follow me on Twitter, which you should do, you'll know I'm obsessed with KanoKari. I've been live tweeting it for months. Mondays are KanoKari Mondays for me. I get excited for these. Every week I read this manga, and every week it's the same bullshit. And every time I just say, inject this shit directly into my bloodstream. I thought it could be fun to talk about why. Hey, so if you like this, it'd be cool if you liked, commented, and subscribed. The reason why every YouTuber says this is because it actually works. So I'd appreciate it. Also, check in the description. I have a link tree that has a Discord that you can join. Information about a podcast I do with my best buddy Raghava, which is on hiatus for right now, but should be back sometime soon. And also Patreon if you want to support the podcast or the stuff I do right here. Patreon, I've been a little bit not great about like uploading stuff and updating stuff and like getting rewards out there. So I totally understand if you look at the infrequent upload schedule and you think it's not worth subscribing to the Patreon. That's totally cool. But if you do want to support what you're listening to, that is the way to do it. No pressure if not. That being said, let's get back to the content. Despite having so much wrong with it, KanoKari has proven to be a fairly difficult show to write about. I still think the hardest show I've ever done one of these for was ReZero, but KanoKari is up there. As this essay will hopefully show, this show is not worth yours or anyone's time beyond my craven personal fascination with it. Yet, paradoxically, it takes a fair amount of thought to make what I'd call a good KanoKari essay. What I don't want to do is just list all the cringy things that happen in order. It would be funny. Others have done it and it's worked for them. People would like it. But it wouldn't be good to me. I think worst of all, it wouldn't be original. I want people who have watched a million of these to watch mine and still feel like they're thinking about the show in a new way. So here's what we do instead. We try and answer 2 main questions up front. 1, what is the root cause of why the story is so terrible? And 2, what makes this story uniquely frustrating, or fun if you're me, to read and watch? My answers, again up front, are this. Rent a Girlfriend is a pretty standard by-the-numbers harem anime built on a fundamentally incelist worldview. But for it to work and have any sort of general appeal, Rent a Girlfriend desperately needs you to believe it isn't a harem show and that it isn't steeped neck deep in incel stench. It is the fact that it tries so adamantly to deny being these things, despite this so obviously being the case, that creates a unique level of insanity in the viewer or reader that scratches all the right brain cells for me in a twisted sort of way. Okay, but what do I mean by all this? Especially this idea of KanoKari needing you to believe something about itself that isn't true? We can build this up together, me and you. We'll make this a semi-interactive anime essay experience, asking the same questions I've been asking since I started following the show in 2020. Hopefully, by the time you finish this essay, you'll understand KanoKari on a level beyond simply being bad or cringy. If you do, I'd say I've done a decent enough job. Miyajima Reiji's Rent-A-Girlfriend is a rom-com that stars schlubby loser and college freshman Kinoshita Kazuya. He looks out into dating his very first girlfriend, Nanami Mami. Suddenly, she dumps him, and worse, blocks him on Twitter. Desperate and, more importantly, horny, as his ex didn't even sleep with him before he broke up, Kazuya stumbles upon a service that offers fake girlfriends for hire. For a few hundred dollars an hour, he can rent a girlfriend, roll credits, to act all cute, hold hands, date, and do everything except kiss or have sex. It's on this platform that Kazuya spots the beautiful and hardworking Ichinose Chizuru, or, as she's called in the rental girlfriend circuit, Mizuhara Chizuru. Vaguely defined anime bullshit leads Kazuya to introduce Chizuru as his real girlfriend to his parents, friends, and dying grandma. Since Chizuru is so beautiful, and since Kazuya is such a massive fucking loser, Kazuya pressures Chizuru into pretending to date him until they can find the right time, read, never, to fake breakup, so she can move on with her life. This is a rom-com, ostensibly anyway, so all the fake dating leads Kazuya to develop real romantic feelings for Mizuhara Chizuru. My word choice is important here, as we'll see later. Likewise, it leads Chizuru to, she blushes a lot, and that's supposed to mean she likes him, but she never says that or acts like that, and never has a reason to feel that way, ever, after being pressured into saving some random guy's social life, so...
It's just, I need you to do me a favor.
Huh? Why should I?
Chizuru tries to get Kazuya off her back by convincing him to date one Sarashina Ruka, a high school senior and rents a girlfriend who falls in love with Kazuya because, we'll get to it. Just know for now it doesn't make any sense. But it is important to know that Kazuya agrees to date Ruka, even though he doesn't like her in the slightest, and Ruka knows this because she had to blackmail him to get him to date her. And likewise, Ruka allows Kazuya to continue to date Chizuru because, like, just roll with it, or we'll be here all day. Also, there's Sumi. She's a Komishoko ripoff. This essay will pretend she does not exist for convenience's sake. A typical arc in this story basically revolves around A, Kazuya reading tea leaves to see if Mizuhara Chizuru acting like his girlfriend. Again, note my wording here. Is somehow a sign she loves him for real, despite the fact that he pays her multiple days worth of his salary a week to act like she likes him. It is always her job to do the things that she does. Then, the arc will develop. Either B, Ruka will apply pressure onto Kazuya to get him to stop dating Chizuru and start taking their actually real relationship seriously, or C, Mami will apply pressure to either Chizuru or Kazuya to get them to break up. Then, something happens that threatens to expose their secret, but they manage to keep it hidden in the end. Finally, every arc ends with D, Ichinose Chizuru, wording, alone in her room, blushing, maybe gently kissing her leg, going, "Baka Kazuya, you're nothing but a client to me, all tsundere-like." And the reader or watcher is led to maybe thinking, this is it, she's finally gonna admit she likes him, but she never does, and we loop back to A. There are a few exceptions to this pattern. Sometimes, when there's especially slow progress, a character Yaomori Mini will show up. She's a Twitch streamer, YouTuber, weeb, and audience surrogate who appears periodically in the story to tell Kazuya that Chizuru, like, totally likes him, bro. He just needs to ask again, even though she said no every single time he's asked here, and, in fact, has tried to repeatedly get him to leave her alone. And there are a few minor arcs with the aforementioned Sakurasawa Sumi, a shy girl who works a rental girlfriend post alongside Chizuru to improve her social anxiety. Like I said, she doesn't exactly affect the plot so much, but people liked her enough that she got her own spin-off series. Since the plot goes nowhere for 250 chapters, it'll make more sense to summarize the characters instead. We'll keep in mind two key points of analysis. Who does KanoKari want you to believe this is? And who is this really, based on what they actually do and say? Later we'll talk about how and why the story tries to trick you into mistaking the former for the latter. What Kazuya is supposed to be is a flawed, relatable male rom-com protagonist navigating through the anxiety of seeing oneself as unattractive. Kazuya is horny and desperate to get a girlfriend, but he doesn't just want a girlfriend to fulfill his physical and emotional needs, he wants a pretty girlfriend for the social status that having an attractive girlfriend can bring men. Both his family and friends apply a ton of pressure onto him to get a sexy girlfriend and to keep Chizuru once he's got her. The idea is that Kazuya is the center of a story about self-improvement and accountability. The first time Kazuya's horniness pushes him to rent Chizuru, he becomes unhinged the second he learns that the little things Chizuru did to make their date worth paying for were, in fact, things she does for all her other clients as well, because this is a job for her and she takes pride in doing her job well.
I mean, really? What are you hoping to achieve? Just being professional? It's so meaningless!
What's wrong with you? Are you stupid? Yelling like that in a public place? Drawing everyone's attention? What is your problem anyway?
Incidentally, this is the only time in this story Chizuru will have a backbone, but we'll save that for the Chizuru section. What this seems to set up is a story where Kazuya and Chizuru's chance encounter leads Kazuya to develop as a person. His lies wrap Chizuru into a mess of his own making. Through doing right by her and accepting that his ex-girlfriend broke up with him in a healthier way than literally paying for a replacement, Kazuya gradually becomes the kind of man women actually want to date. Maybe then he dates Chizuru or finds someone else, but the arc would be the focus. There are lines where the characters talk about how many people use the rental girlfriend service as a way to get comfortable talking to women. When they improve as people down the line, they can get themselves a real, healthy relationship. In a vacuum, it is pretty thoughtful. Kazuya, in reality, though, is just an abuser. Well, he's a business major, so that's a given, but still. So here's the dirty secret about redemption arcs. For a redemption arc to work, the character being redeemed has to already be a good person. It's counterintuitive, but think about it. In real life, in order to recognize that you've harmed someone else and to truly do what it takes to make that situation better, there are certain positive qualities you already have to have. You have to have the empathy to understand that you've messed up, the humility to accept criticism from others, even when that criticism is harmful. You have to have the discipline to stick to changing your habits and the dedication to closing all the loose ends with the people that you've hurt. He instead has the traits of a repeat sex offender. First of all, there's the fact that multiple women in the story, including both his ex-girlfriend and Chizuru at times, state openly that his behavior makes them uncomfortable. It's usually around the way he stares at women like an idiot. But wait, there's more! Want to know why Kazuya and Chizuru keep dating after the first one? It's because Kazuya emotionally blackmails Chizuru into dating him. Maybe that sounds like a lot, but what would you call go on a date with me or my parents will hate me forever and my sick and dying grandma will rest in the grave thinking she'll never have grandchildren? Because that's what he says, even after Chizuru rightly points out that he can just take responsibility for his own family and tell his grandma no at any time. Also, just rereading this for my sake, she says it's blackmail, and he doesn't even fucking deny it. Oh, and let's not forget the actual stalking. It's Christmas Eve, and Kazuya notices Chizuru out and about with a tall, handsome, artsy-looking pretty boy named Umi. The idea that Chizuru would date losers like him for money while dating an actual attractive person with common interests in her real life is such a betrayal for him that he decides to follow her around all day. He follows the two to the movies, to the mall, into public spaces from the early afternoon until past sunset. Given when the sun sets in Japan around Christmas, that amounts to anywhere from 4 to 6 hours of following someone in public and seething. I don't think any words I write on this page can quantify just how gross and disqualifying this is for any romance protagonist. Besides the fact that this sort of behavior is not funny or cute, and besides the fact that stalking and sexual harassment by men are something that women and other marginalized genders have to protect themselves from daily, narratively, what this tells me is that at his core, Kazuya is a spoiled, entitled brat. It's not a betrayal of Kazuya's trust or effort that Chizuru, as beautiful as she is, date an equally beautiful man if she wants to. We are seriously not even one step removed from incels.co style rhetoric. Oh, the Stacys just want Chad Thundercock to treat them like shit. No girl wants a nice guy like me.
You just get dumped right away! It doesn't matter how much you care about your partner!
Such embarrassing behavior. These men admit that they are ugly and that they are losers, but will never in a million years date a woman that they find ugly themselves. So, on the one hand, every pretty girl that doesn't give a self-described ugly guy the time of day is a horrible tramp single-handedly responsible for his self-loathing and suicidal ideation. These women don't deserve to be with men they actually like and should instead be stuck with them. On the other hand, these men absolutely deserve a pretty and attentive girlfriend for themselves, and it's cruel to make them settle for anything less. The reality is, attraction isn't logical. Period. I mean, lest you get your romance advice from Internet Pikachu over here. There are some trends and averages we can point to and agonize over all day. Oh, girls like tall guys. Oh, girls like big dick. Oh, girls like a maximum Carthel tilt of 15 degrees. Shut up. No one cares. Every individual person likes vastly different kinds of people, and your only job is finding another individual who likes you back. Any more whinging over what men deserve or how women are sluts who just like hot guys is pathetic and sexist. Chizuru does yell at Kazuya for stalking, but not because it's criminal, dangerous behavior. Well, she does make a passing reference to calling the cops, but her main concern is that to her, this level of obsessiveness is something only her boyfriend should be doing.
That's so stupid. Who do you think you are, my boyfriend?
Which? Whole other problem. Jesus Christ, babe, are you okay? But the point is that this kind of behavior from Kazuya is never challenged. Kazuya will lie to everyone he knows about dating an extremely attractive woman. He'll get all the attention and social clout from people believing the lie. He'll then apologize for dragging Chizuru deeper and deeper into his mess, for upsetting his ex-girlfriend further, or for getting Chizuru embarrassed or yelled at. He'll do a bunch of super nice stuff for her. He'll sit there and call himself trash. He'll cry about how much of an awful person he is. He'll do just about everything, except stopping the shitty behavior. And that's the key part. In real life and in fiction, we often conflate self-flagellation and gracious apology making for accountability. We think that bad people can't hate themselves and incorrectly assume that those who perform self-hatred must at least be good-natured. But if those eloquent apologies don't come with commitments, what you are is a manipulator with low self-esteem. Kazuya is this manipulator, but the narrative framing is unironically on his side, and so is the entire KanoKari fandom. Reading the story fucks with you in subtle ways because Kazuya fucks with you in subtle ways.
Wow, well, you are still a virgin after all, Kazuya. And virgins can't bear virgin.
Ichinose Chizuru is a character that seems fun to write an OC character sheet for, if that makes any sense. We're meant to believe that Chizuru is a strong-willed, well-rounded character, a love interest with bite and personality. An anime girl who's not like the other anime girls. On the face of things, Chizuru's a struggling actress who's using the rental girlfriend job and the character she made for it, Mizuhara Chizuru, wording, to practice acting and save up enough to transfer to an acting school. Currently, she studies Japanese literature, but she lives for all things drama. When she's not at university, she works with a theatrical troupe putting on local plays. There are also secondary things about her that are fun, and I actually appreciate it. She's into working out, to the point that she has gym equipment lying around all over her apartment. She loves sports. Whenever she wants to let off steam, she'll head to a local batting cage and swing a few rounds. She gets really excited when she beats her personal record. The characters all go on a double date, where both parties are renting girlfriends, by the way, to this rock climbing place. Chizuru is naturally good at it, and it's a lot of fun for her. The scene is undercut by everyone ogling her ass, but yeah.
Am I really even allowed to watch this? I can practically see her ass through those shorts!
This is, by the way, the happiest Chizuru will ever look. When she's doing her hobbies, you get glimpses of this character in a functional show with a non-abusive love interest, who's actually worth the effort in supporting. Chizuru, somewhat obviously, is really pretty. Partly because she's drawn that way, partly because Reiji can't go 5 fucking seconds without a scene where a bunch of random men stare at her body and make comments, but also, and this is the good bit, because she makes an effort to look pretty. Huge boobs and a cute face are genetic things, but having those things doesn't necessarily translate into being seen as pretty. She does work out to keep her overall figure thin. She wears her hair in styles that evoke a specific feeling. Same with her makeup and clothes. Being pretty is a choice she makes to play the character Mizuhara Chizuru, and she's damn good in the role. Not just good, actually. The best, right? She's the most popular rental girlfriend on the platform. She only gets 5-star reviews. Not to mention she's practically the best actress in her troupe. Surprisingly, Chizuru is allowed to be proud of these accomplishments. Not a ton of female characters get to be proud like she is. Would you believe me if I said the fandom absolutely hates her? Well, they do. They call her Chorizo and everything, so. The problem with Chizuru, for us, is not really her character in a vacuum. I understand that in a lot of media criticism essays, having good characters means you have a good story. And having a good story means you have good characters. It may feel unnatural to claim that Chizuru is good, but the qualities that make her good contribute to KanoKari being awful. I will try and explain. Chizuru may be a complex character, but that complexity never serves herself. She is only complex and interesting insofar as it makes her more, like, bangable. Actually, bangable is a short-sighted description. If Chizuru is an object for men to win, her character traits only ever exist to make her value as an object increase. Her character traits are like the features you list on a used Nintendo Switch in good condition you're flipping on eBay. New girlfriend, unopened, plays sports and is a struggling actress, ultra pale skin and double D's, includes AC power cable, Joy-Cons, dock, HDMI cable, and verified tsundere attitude.
Oh man, I really want one. I want one.
Chizuru is the most highly accomplished rental girlfriend in the country, but she will never prioritize another client over Kazuya to keep her job. Chizuru may be an actress, but she will never be unavailable to Kazuya because she's pursuing her own dreams. When Chizuru doesn't get recruited into an agency after a big play, she is only disappointed so that Kazuya can be the one to cheer her up. In public. Loudly. Chizuru is pretty, but only so that Kazuya's ex is jealous of her body. She's pretty, but only so that her very presence can cause men to break down and random couples to break up. Chizuru works out, but only in the sense that being skinny makes her worth more. She has friends, but they disappear from the narrative as her life begins to revolve around Kazuya. On top of none of her character traits actually ever being about her, her constant obsession with Kazuya is unjustified, which is important if you're doing a romance. Otherwise, It's shameless pandering to an audience that gets zero bitches. I'm talking about zero play. In short, Kazuya has zero, what's it called? Redeeming qualities. Yeah, that's it. He has zero redeeming qualities. He's not good looking. He has no ambition in life. He's a menace to society. So why does she even put up with him? At some point, it gets a little sad. I don't know what trope to call this. It's not exactly a manic pixie dream girl, but a related idea. It's seeing a female character not as herself, but as a piece in a fever dream of a man's fantasy. If you've noticed, I've drawn your attention to instances where I refer to Chizuru as Ichinose Chizuru versus Mizuhara Chizuru. Here's why. My assertion is that Mizuhara Chizuru is not a real person, and she is certainly not Ichinose Chizuru. Mizuhara is a character that Ichinose Chizuru plays when she is doing her job. This is super important to understanding Mizuhara as a whole. You think that in a story like this, Ichinose Chizuru, who spends all her time putting on smiles and faces for others, who has dedicated her life to looking perfect, will learn how to drop the mask around people she grows to love. As Chizuru and Kazuya spend genuine time together outside of rental dates, and as Kazuya begins to change for the better, Chizuru would realize that she doesn't have to play the character of Mizuhara Chizuru around Kazuya. It fit the theme of her being an actress and everything. In the actual text, though, Ichinose is actually Mizuhara's mask. It's little stuff, like the fact that she puts on glasses to be Ichinose, but never wears them anywhere else. This is the look, to be honest. More generally, every arc about opening up to Kazuya always involves getting her to act like Mizuhara, acting like the dream girlfriend in places she shouldn't.
No, you're wrong. You've kept this charade going all this time because you want to keep seeing him.
In KanoKari, romance is when women perform the role of the perfect girlfriend. The more the woman performs, the romancier it is. Crucially, Kazuya never shows any attraction to Ichinose. In fact, he refuses to use her name. All his friends do, but not him. These two clips are actually from the same chapter. I mentioned 239 in the introduction. In it, Chizuru says the most insightful thing she has ever said in this entire manga. In fact, dare I say, the only good lines in KanoKari in existence are said by her. She says, "Doesn't it cross your mind that my job is to make people fall in love with me? You told me I could be myself, but it's not like I've shown you the real me all the way through. There are still parts of me that are make-believe. So if you tell me you love me, I can't help but think, are you really okay with that? Maybe the girl you love is Mizuhara Chizuru, you know?" In this moment, the story gets dangerously close to saying a thing about a thing. Mizuhara Chizuru is a character Ichinose Chizuru performs. To her, a client who fell in love with her fell in love with a persona she can only realistically keep up for 2, maybe 3 hours. If Kazuya says he loves her, all that tells Chizuru is that she's a good actress. What exactly is she supposed to feel other than confused, guilty, and a little creeped out? And yet, immediately after, Kazuya says, "Mizuhara will never be mine." Mizuhara, why? And fucking Reiji knows he's doing it because the other characters point this out to him. So it's on purpose. You can't argue that I'm not supposed to be reading into it. It's just so bad and terrible. And again, it's on purpose. I mentioned a fandom hating Chizuru. In a nutshell, it's because she refuses to perform this fantasy for Kazuya, even after hundreds of chapters of him displaying how nice he is. It is a transaction where him saying nice things is exchanged for her perpetual performance of Mizuhara Chizuru exclusively for him. We are watching a perfectly good and interesting character trapped in a story that refuses to see her as an actual person or even use her name. When compiled with the fact that Chizuru never even makes it clear she likes Kazuya at all, it is legitimately horrifying to read at times. In this one panel here, Kazuya has been trying to contact Chizuru for weeks. He knocks on her door several times a day, sends multiple texts a day, keeps her mail so he can pretend he found it as a reason to talk to her. And see, Chizuru is avoiding him because she was forced to kiss him to keep up the lie of their fake relationship. And this has exhausted her and made her feel guilty. She crawls away from the door, away from Kazuya. Doesn't even make it to a bed before collapsing. What am I reading? This is cute. Free her. Christ on a stick. Nanami Mami has done nothing wrong in her life ever. That's it. Sarashina Ruka is supposed to be Kazuya's girlfriend. She... Huh? Explain Mami? I thought it was obvious. She did nothing wrong. Did you even listen? Okay. Wait. I'll explain. Relax. Nanami Mami is Rent-A-Girlfriend's main antagonist. We're meant to see her as the spiteful, vindictive ex who uses her sexuality to manipulate Kazuya into breaking it off with Chizuru. We're meant to dread whenever she shows up on screen. Like a bully kicking over your sandcastle at the beach, Mami's role is to take anything that Chizuru and Kazuya might have built and destroy it. I will note that the character KanoKari wants you to believe Mami is could probably be described as a number of vaguely sexist TV trope entries. She's a vamp, a hate sink, a clingy jealous girl, and a woman scorn, just off the top of my head. Mami's list of alleged crimes, in the first season anyway, start from the beginning. We're meant to think that she dumped Kazuya and blocked him on Twitter. Twitter! For no reason. She embarrasses him, then tries to kiss him. She leads him on only to control him, apparently for no other reason than she just finds it fun to fuck with Chizuru and Kazuya. Also, she makes this face all the time. This is an evil face, as we all know. She will also go on megalomaniacal rants on her private Twitter about how evil she is, because she's evil! Evil, I say! At some point, there's a chapter in which she gets a tragic backstory that I tried to find the reference for, but I gave up because I didn't care enough about it. She pretty much had a boyfriend once in high school, but her parents ruined it. Now Mommy's made it her personal life mission to destroy love wherever she sees it. There are a few contrarians who claim to like Mami. The chief reason, if we're being honest, 80% of the time, if something almost interesting happens in KanoKari, it's because Mami started it. She is a plot device that forces tension and progress in a cyclical story where nothing truly changes. She is the stealth rock of rom-coms. Exactly one person understands what that means. People will be like, yeah, she's a liar, but she's fun to watch. Or, yeah, she's evil, but she creates drama. A guy like me, I don't say stuff like that. In fact, I don't even think stuff like that. Because I'm not a pussy baby coward. I will insist that Mami is literally the good guy of KanoKari. The only reason she looks evil is because the story is written from Kazuya's point of view, and Kazuya, as we all know, is a psychotic stalker incel little freak. So of course, by looking at the world through the eyes of a psychotic stalker incel little freak, any woman that doesn't like him will look like a bitch. Imagine for a second, you're in college, and you've got a decent friend group going. You've never dated someone because dating's kind of a sore subject for you. Then, out of the blue, a friend introduces you to this guy. He's into you, like really, really into you. You figure you'll go ahead and date him, but not because you feel anything towards him exactly, but because he's there. You decide to give this love crap everyone keeps telling you is so great a shot. You date him for like a month. It's never that serious. You do all the cute shit, like holding hands and talking about how cute your babies could be. You kiss once. It's just not working. Love still doesn't make you feel anything. On top of that, the dude you decided to date is just weird. He's always horny. He was always staring at your body, just waiting for the day he lets you under his skirt. He was quite literally always hard, sometimes in public. You kissed him that one time. Now he wanted it every time, and he was pushy about it too. He was constantly touching you, constantly taking you out to drink, late in an obvious attempt to get you drunk enough to sleep with him, a generally unpleasant experience all around. These are things that Mami says, In this scene, neither Kazuya or Chizuru deny this. Mami is only told she's wrong for bringing it up. You dump him as nice as you can and try to move on. But not even a week later, he comes back with a new girl. She is seriously the most beautiful woman you have ever seen in your entire life. He keeps bringing this supermodel of a GF to events that are supposed to just be you and your friends. Everyone's staring at her, everyone takes her side over yours. You even hear some of them saying that she's so hot that if your ex has sex with her, it'll ruin sex forever. She makes you feel thoroughly replaceable. So yeah, maybe you do kiss your ex-boyfriend, and maybe it's super poor judgment. You're naturally confused, pissed, and jealous. A little while later, you see your ex again with another pretty girl. You make polite small talk before this girl, Sumi is her name, quickly tells you that she's Kazuya's girlfriend. You have apparently caught your ex-boyfriend cheating on the supermodel for, like, fun, you guess, with another supermodel. Despite the fact that he does not deserve it, you tell your ex that his secret is safe with you and you leave. At this point, you're miserable. You're still alone, you still don't get love, your friends hate you, and your ex-boyfriend, who was a loser when you dated, is now apparently drowning in so much supermodel pussy he can't even go one at a time. On a whim, you decide to search for your ex's girlfriend, who's being cheated on, by the way, as far as you know, and discover she's actually something called a rental girlfriend. It was all a lie. Your ex essentially spent thousands of Japanese yen, hundreds of dollars, to spite you, to embarrass you in front of your friends, to make you jealous, to get in your head, and to convince you that he's moved on when he clearly hasn't. This one day, by the way, is like $130. Anyway, all because what? Because you had the fucking nerve to break up with him? After he was the one being weird? I'd fucking go nuts. I'd go scorched earth. I'd make sure this guy never had a social life again. I would not let this shit slide. I would end the charade the first chance I got. Maybe I'd be petty. Maybe I would. But there's nothing pettier than spending fucking $300 a week on a fake girlfriend just to spite me because you got dumped. What does Mami do? Does she get justifiably angry? No. She literally just sits Chizuru down, takes her out on a date, gets her karaoke and a drink, calls her pretty, and just politely requests that she stop lying to all of her friends, maybe, at some point, whenever's good for her. Because, understandably, it's sort of pissing Mami off a little.
The people at college seriously believe it's real. Kazuya paying all this money just so he can show you off as his girlfriend. All of it ticks me off. Just a little bit.
She even points out how unhealthy this is for Kazuya, even though she has no obligation to think about such a thing. The only thing she does that's kind of shitty, I think, is pressuring Chizuru into kissing Kazuya to try and expose them as a fake couple, because that gets consent involved. But even then, Chizuru promised her that she would stop participating in what Mami would see as a targeted campaign against her specifically and her social life. And she agreed that if Mami gave her an out to this fake relationship stuff, she would take it. Instead, Chizuru prioritizes a fake relationship that only harms her and only exists to spite Mami over keeping a pretty reasonable promise. I cannot even begin to describe how insane that actually is. I just remembered that in this one exchange, Mami calls Chizuru a common back alley whore. She did a whore phobia. That's one bad thing. But it was funny, so it's okay. And also, this is not something she would have said if the author himself wasn't weird about this rental girlfriend stuff. And after Kazuya basically emotionally torments her ex for a year, Chizuru has the audacity to be like, well, maybe you just have a crush on him. Ever think about that? Didn't think so. After all that, that's what she has to say. It's like, oh shit, Mami mad, she going ham. Yeah, nigga, you'd be too. Mommy's the only person in this story who is as sick of all of Kazuya's incel bullshit as I am. We have the exact same energy, petty, spiteful, aromantic, and a commitment to the immortal science of Marxism-Leninism, Kazuya not deserving shitism. She is the representation of how Kazuya's behavior affects other people. Neither Kazuya nor the story can own up to that, so Mami gets villainized instead. Nanami Mami, or as I will say from here on out, Gotami Mami, is the anti-hero we all deserve. In a good story, she'd be the best fucking character in the whole roster. Easily. There are few things I am more passionate about in life. I shouldn't take all the credit for this observation. The video which really, I think, nailed what Mami actually does in this story was actually the joystick systems video. I feel like most people who are reading or listening to this have probably seen it. It's a really good video that lays the groundwork for what I'm doing here. Joyce also argues that Mami is probably a lesbian. She's constantly calling Chizuru and Ruka pretty. She checks Chizuru out at least once, and her whole character is based around the fact that dating men makes her feel empty and bitter. Every time she tries to date a girl, it's more than once, it's framed as this sinister thing.
Please just sing.
And, you know, there's also panels like this too. So there are arguments that Mami is not only othered in the story because she, unlike Chizuru, really forces Kazuya to face the consequences of his shitty actions from time to time. Mami is also othered by coding her as a lesbian, which would make the story queerphobic. It's a bit of a read, but I am fully convinced of this. I am proudly the world's only Mami x Chizuru shipper, okay? These two represent the story we could have gotten if only Miyajima Reiji was not messed up in the fucking head. But instead of going into it more, I'll just let you know, again, it's been done better elsewhere, so go watch that. Mami works so well as a protagonist if you think about it, especially like in a Yuri about a girl like finally understanding why romance never seemed to work for her. Crazy thing is, none of this shit was intentional. If you just write from Kazuya's abusive perspective, you're railroaded into doing this to his ex-girlfriend. Sarashina Ruka is supposed to be Kazuya's current girlfriend. See, she has a heart condition and it makes her heart beat slow. She can't do strenuous exercise without passing out. As such, she's looking for a man that can make her heart race back to normal. That means it's true love or something. Ruka becomes a rental girlfriend to aid in her search. Would a pacemaker eliminate the need for this? Sure, but this is what we have to work with, so there. Some anime shenanigans later, and Kazuya's already grabbing her boob, which means she's a love interest now. It's anime, bada bing bada boom, he gets her heart to go doki doki, and now she's convinced that Kazuya is her one true love. Kazuya, of all people? Okay. Anyway, instead of asking him out, she blackmails Kazuya with a recording of him admitting that Chizuru is a rental girlfriend. So much blackmail in this show. What is this, The Boys? Ruka is a little different from the other characters. With the other three, there was a clear what the show wants you to think versus what the show actually says and does. But here, there's not much of a delineation. I think I can keep this bit simple. Ruka is clingy and annoying. She's sort of like Mami, in the sense that she is another obstacle in the way of Chizuru and Kazuya getting together. Since Kazuya technically has a girlfriend, Chizuru feels bad for even being near Kazuya and making Ruka feel bad. Whereas Mami messes with Chizuru and Kazuya out of spite and antagonism, Ruka messes with Chizuru to compete with her. The interesting thing here is that every bad thing Ruka does to Kazuya, Kazuya does to Chizuru or Mami. Ruka stalks him, she touches him when he doesn't want to, she reads way more into the relationship than is actually there, she tries to get him drunk. Them dating would solve the central conceit of the show. So, what's the big idea? Why don't they just date? The two would certainly deserve each other. KanoKari wants to have its cake and eat it too. It wants the victim complex of Kazuya's perpetual virginity. It wants those jealous and bewildered men wondering how bro pulled a baddie like that. It wants these scenes of Kazuya jacking off to Chizuru's shower noises, wondering if he'll ever find happiness. It wants to revel in the righteous persecution of being dumped for trivial things, like not respecting boundaries. But the story simultaneously wants a bevy of smoking hot babes orbiting Kazuya 24/7. His hot ex-girlfriend is secretly into him, his hotter current girlfriend is into him, but Kazuya's got so many options, he doesn't even see her. After all, there's a cute redhead side chick that's into him. And of course, the hottest, most perfect, sporty actress girl in all the land is totally into him too. Like we asserted in our thesis, Kanojo Okarishimasu wants to be a harem. It just wants to be a realistic one. A harem that doesn't feel like you're indulging in all these sad, unrealistic tropes, even when you are. When I say that KanoKari wants to convince you that it's something it's not, and KanoKari wants to be a realistic harem, what that means is a lot of features of the story people identify as writing mistakes are actually malicious. I finished my series on isekai last year. Last year? Oh god, seriously? Last year. And one thing I talked about in there was the rise of post-ironic isekai. A big thing that thrust isekai onto the scene was the male fantasy aspect. Stories about virgins and nerds who don't fit in but were suddenly teleported to a world where what made them virgins in their past life makes them cool, powerful, and loved by girls here. However, it's kind of embarrassing to watch something that so blatantly panders to this thinking. What started happening with isekai is that they got meta. These stories went out of their way to prove to readers that they were not like other isekai. They were darker, grittier, and more realistic than those cringe baby stories. Or they were wrapped up in comedy, inviting you not to take anything seriously, with lines like, oh no, it's the famous isekai truck, or what's this, a gacha game? The key thing in my essay was to point out that this didn't make those new stories any different. They were just less corny. Viewers that wanted a true break from the isekai power fantasy stuff would have to look elsewhere. This is where KanoKari is. It is probably one of the most self-indulgent harem manga ever written. But the story is aware of this, and doesn't want you to think of it like a corny harem manga. It wants you to read what is essentially an audience self-insert paying and manipulating hot girls into dating him, but it doesn't want you to think you're lame for reading it. I feel like this is most clear in season 2 of the anime. They balance the manga content so all the girls get the same amount of screen time. And it's mostly different girls fighting over Kazuya. Mami and Chizuru fight over him, Mami and Ruka, Ruka and Chizuru. They all up the ante to get in his pants without establishing if they even like him or what he brings to the table. To accomplish this, it adds all this other bullshit. Bullshit like, maybe the story is really about the pain of getting over your first breakup. Bullshit like, maybe the story is really about becoming a better person in the end. Bullshit like, maybe this waifu actually has a personality, and she actually calls out the main character when he fucks up. It dangles the promise of subverting expectations over your head, because that promise makes you forget you have, in fact, read this garbage before. Please don't bully me, Nagatoro, dress up darling, Uzaki-chan wants to hang out, and Komi can't communicate are all romance manga with anime adaptations that traffic in the same sort of I am a virgin man between the ages of 16 and 25 demographic. The main pairs in Komi can't communicate and Uzaki-chan wants to hang out are like together, all before the 100th chapter. In Dress Up Darling, the main couple, Marin and Gojo, are not together, but the girl confesses before chapter 50. In Nagatoro, there hasn't been a confession yet, as far as I'm aware, but they are actual friends who do couple things in half the chapters KanoKari has. I'm not really a huge fan of any of these stories. I'd say Komi Can't Communicate is a dumpster fire, Uzaki-chan is pretty bad, Nagatoro isn't really for me, and Dress Up Darling is okay at best. The idea here is that they're all actual romances. You know, the genre where romance happens. KanoKari is longer. Every last one of these manga except for Komi Can't Communicate. And it has far less progress in all of these. I can't load up chapter 218 of Komi after having only read the beginning and understand what's happening. But I can do that for KanoKari. People keep talking about KanoKari like it's a failed romance. It isn't. It never meant to try. Fake dating, the endless we should break up soons, even the pervasive NTR stuff is the point. You're not supposed to want progress, you're supposed to want the wacky premise, the incel fantasy, the fetish, and the fan service. KanoKari simply wraps it all up in plausible deniability. The only reason that KanoKari is seeing a decline is because 218, understandably, made it very difficult to pretend that this story is ordinary. This panel's so fucking good, by the way. I would frame this if I could. It's so amazing. Look at that. But even then, the dip of KanoKari's popularity is kind of minor in the grand scheme of things. KanoKari's first season has a 7.16 on MAL, while its second season has only dipped to like a 6.86. By contrast, when people turned on the Rising of the Shield Hero second season, it dropped from an 8.1 to a 6.56, right? In reality, most of the people who silently liked KanoKari for what it was still like KanoKari for what it is. These people realize the truth. There is no progress in the story because there isn't supposed to be. According to KanoKari's philosophy, the problem with Nagatoro, Dress Up Darling, Uzaki-chan, or Komi is that there is still for people who deep down believe they can find, say, the Kirigawa Marin to their Wakana Gojo. KanoKari, by contrast, is a fantasy for people who straight up do not believe that romance is possible for them, to the point where something with actual romance, where people flirt and stuff, alienates them. It is much more comfortable and realistic to these people that the girl in the fantasy only really be interested in the man because he is paying her. That she only see him because they happen to live next door and go to the same school and have all the same friends. That she don't stop talking to him because leaving him would mean the end of her social life, reputation, and job, and maybe also his grandma dead from distress. All of this, in hopes that maybe, after all that coercion, the girl starts to like the guy for real. That's, you know, sad and stuff. KanoKari fails on a lot of fronts, as we've talked about throughout this essay. It fails to advance its own narrative, it fails to develop its female lead, it fails to have an evil antagonist that does anything actually evil, it fails to distinguish itself from typical harem schlock, though it tries hard to convince you otherwise. But I think, most simply and strikingly of all, KanoKari is a romance that fails to have any romance. Nowhere in KanoKari's now over 250 chapters are any two characters romantically attracted to each other. All of the relationships in this story are blackmail or people just being miserable. Mami and Kazuya dated, but it's questionable if Mami even likes men. Mami's initial attraction to Kazuya was nothing more than a cynical attempt to try and feel something in her dead, aromantic lesbian heart, and her current obsession with him is just jealousy over Chizuru. If Chizuru does end up solidly falling in love with Kazuya, it'll feel more like Stockholm Syndrome than an actual romance. Most of their relationship is our grandmas would be sad if we don't pretend to like each other. And of course, from Kazuya's perspective, their relationship is just him blackmailing to fuel his own insecurity, desire for status, and lust. Would it surprise you to know that Kazuya and Chizuru never once voluntarily hang out with each other? Only very recently, in chapter 252, does Chizuru agree to join Kazuya for a drink. But she's actually joining their mutual friend Mini, so it barely counts. The story will write itself into all kinds of bizarre situations that could easily be solved with having the main pair just flirt once. But instead of doing so, the story will come up with even more bizarre, random situations to these self-inflicted bizarre problems that only exist because someone tried to write a rom-com with absolutely zero rom. Watching this story plod along with all its excuses and eccentricities, confidently stumbling through chapter after chapter as if it isn't missing the only thing necessary for a romance story to work, actual romance, is just so fundamentally interesting to me. This train wreck alone would keep me reading, but the cherry on top is all the lying the manga does. The story will lie about simple things that just happened. It will ask you to find Ruka annoying as if it didn't just ask you to sympathize with Kazuya for doing the exact same thing. It will ask you to hate Mami without actually having her do anything hate-worthy. It will have Chizuru call Kazuya nice, act flustered when she sees him, as if we didn't just watch him stalk her or blackmail her. It will have you totally convinced that Chizuru will confess her undying love to Kazuya any day now without actually having her act like she likes him ever? Ever. The only comparable experience I've had is watching The Room with a bunch of friends a few years back, where the thing takes itself so seriously, yet it's so bad, and also it hates women, and the guy who made it is just as much of a goofy character as the characters in the world of the piece. And then Claudette goes, "I got the results of the test back. I definitely have breast cancer." And, you know, how are you not invested after an incredible line like that? That's the real question. It's exhausting, it's ceaseless, and I think it's the only time I can confidently say I'm legitimately being gaslit by fiction. I'm in an abusive relationship with KanoKari, though unlike real gaslighting and real abuse, it's honestly kind of fun and strange and exciting. And the tweets I get out of it are legendary, of course. It helps I could just opt out of it at any time if I feel it's getting on my nerves, but I find myself always coming back when I'm recharged and ready for more craziness. There's one scene from the film Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse where Miles Morales, the titular Spider-Man, intentionally fails a multiple choice quiz by answering every single question wrong. His teacher points out that selecting bubbles at random would reward you a score of around 25%, not zero. The only logical conclusion to that situation was that Miles knew the correct answers and failed on purpose. Likewise, I think it takes skill and intention to write something as profoundly empty, wheel spinny, and downright uncomfortable as KanoKari. If KanoKari was poorly written, blind, and by incompetence, it would occasionally, accidentally, stumble upon something happening. I hate The Rising of the Shield Hero. I think it is awful. I think it is poorly written. I think it is poorly executed. Stuff happens in that show. The fact that KanoKari has made no progress since its debut in 2017 tells me Miyajima Reiji knows how to write progress and doesn't. If I were to take a guess, I'd argue that Miyajima Reiji doesn't even really care about KanoKari as a story. He just wants to draw pretty girls going on dates with our main guy. He wants to do pinups of Chizuru in a bikini or in the shower or something, but that doesn't make any money. So he's come up with a manga concept that is just plausible enough to make sales, with no commitment to make anything happen anytime soon. In the meantime, he just fills the panels with waifus. So one day, Reiji will draw a picture of Chizuru in his real-life shower, or he'll paint Chizuru's panties on his real-life carpet, and he'll post it on Twitter, and we'll be like, dude, what is this? Why? And look, I admit it. The art is really good. I do art, and I would like to study this piece. Especially in like the, you know, the shapes of the and the colors in the hair and the rendering of the skin. And I think we all know if the art wasn't so pretty, this whole elaborate gaslighting scheme would fall flat on its face immediately. On the one hand, if all Reiji really wants to do is draw cute little pinups and short comics of dates with his imaginary and unreasonably pretty college girls, he absolutely can do that. I will not stop him. I would suggest acquiring healthier views on women while he's at it, especially since he is married. But for the most part, you won't hear from me on that. On the other hand, he should also, maybe, never be allowed near a script again. Maybe don't give the blackmail and romance art the same guy a new sibling romance manga. Maybe it's okay if he just doesn't write that. If it's Crunchyroll or the Kenojo Okarishimasu production committee that's making him write more because the figures and books and anime sell like hotcakes, it's probably fine. We are probably good. We've had enough KanoKari. We do not need any more, thanks. Ah, god fucking damn.
I'm gonna rent you next week!
Huh?
And then I'll rent you the week after that, and the week after that too! I won't stop!
Do you have any idea how much money that's gonna cost you?
No, and I don't care!
But Kazuya!
I'll get a job to pay for it, and I'll keep working week after week, so I can afford to keep renting you week after week. I'll work my ass off to pay for you if I have to! I don't care, you deserve it!
Come on now, stop being ridiculous!
Wouldn't you stop being stupid? You've been working so hard every single day!
Okay, hi. So this is a special feature for people who are patient enough to watch until the end of the video, and also a treat for being patient and waiting this long. While I was working on this, I remembered that KanoKari chapter 231 exists. And 231 is interesting because it's right after Chizuru and Kazuya kiss, right? So they just kissed, and now he's like, oh my gosh, I just kissed. The world turned pink. He says that like 500 fucking times. I can't believe it. I kissed, blah, blah, blah. And so there's a lot of, since we kissed, that means you like me, right? And Chizuru's like, well, I mean, I have pretended to kiss you before, you know, to save this fucking joke of a relationship we got going on. And so it's all like, dang, it basically undoes all the progress. Like, she went from kissing him twice to undoing all of the fucking progress that they made and just calling him, like, he's just my client, I don't want to kiss, blah, blah, blah. Typical KanoKari stuff. But the reason why this chapter is special is because Kazuya says, probably, I think, one of the most iconic Kazuya lines, right? He says, the kiss, exclamation mark. Of course I would, exclamation mark. Just 4 wee hours ago, exclamation mark. No matter the way, shape, or form, I did it with her. With this angel, who looks like she was spat out by a neural network. With Mizuhara. The whirl of her hair is cute. Her wrists are cute. Shit, even her mitochondria look cute. And this line is so fucking amazing. How the fuck are someone's organelles sexy, dude? This is what I want to know. How is a Golgi apparatus sexy? How's the nucleus sexy? You go to a tree, you say it has sexy chloroplasts? I just want to know. I just want to understand, okay? So anyway, I was reading this, I was having fun, and I was thinking, can I get a neural network to redesign Chizuru Mizuhara, right? And so it just so happens that I had also applied for open access to DALL-E, like the convolutional neural network that generates images based on text, right? And I was like, I still have to read that paper. Okay, anyway, I'll write about it later. So they were like, put your social media so we can trust you. So I put like @__moblack, and I was like, immediately approved. I guess they saw all my like KanoKari tweets and hot takes, and they're like, oh hell yeah, this is a guy we want using our service, right? So it was like 4 a.m. I have insomnia, so I woke up in the middle of the night, and I couldn't fall asleep, and I saw this email that I had been approved to DALL-E to, and I was like, fuck it, let's do it, right? So here's my journey for trying to recreate Chizuru in an actual neural network to see if we can verify the claim that Chizuru Mizuhara looks like a girl that was created by a neural network. So first thing I tried, of course, the perfect girlfriend. We got four. I hate the way AI draws hands. It really fucking like creeps me out. But we got like four white women. It was interesting. But none of these are Chizuru, right? So I said, me and the perfect girlfriend on a date, right? You know, just trying to get a little closer. And it was just like more white people. So I was like, okay, I don't think this is working. I think we need to specify the style, right? Because they were like, yeah, if you want digital art, you put like digital art. So I said, me and the perfect girlfriend on a date at a trendy cafe on a beautiful autumn evening in an anime. And I discovered something that is going to come into play later. And the thing that I discovered is that apparently all of the data points that Dolly is trained on that are labeled as anime, I guess they all like come from DeviantArt or something, because they all have like the same like 2012 like a 13-year-old drawing her first anime picture for the first time vibe. Like, none of them look like an actual like anime, right? So as you can see, like, especially like the top right here, and then there's this one, which is just Jesus fucking Christ. So I'm like, okay, what if I just input her description, right? So I just like, dark hair, pale skin, tall, sporty, actress, the perfect girlfriend in manga. And this was, I feel like this was too many things. Oh, here's like thing number two. If you tell Dolly that you want someone tall, it will just give you a person whose face is cut off. Which I think is a little insulting, because I'm tall myself. Like, what I want someone with long legs. I don't want somebody whose face is like cut off like this. Like, look at these two people on the right. Actually, I'm glad that the top right girl is whose face is cut off. First of all, her dress and hair are the same, and her eyes, Jesus fucking Christ. But bottom right, minus her completely fucked up hand. Was sort of getting there, right? It was sort of, this isn't Chizuru, but like, you know, we're getting there. With a few tweaks, we could get there. So I was like, maybe if I iterate on this design, and unfortunately iteration did not bring me any closer. But oh my God, is this not like the stuff of Horus? Christ. Okay. So I moved on. So I was like, okay, maybe it should be on a date, right? So me on a date with my tall, dark skin, pale skin, dark haired, pale skin, sporty actress, perfect girlfriend in an anime. So this time I just did the same, but anime instead of manga. And I got more just like DeviantArt stuff. There's so much stuff that creeps me out, right? The hands creep me out, the eyes creep me out. But also like when it's like unreadable text that's supposed to be readable, that like my skin is crawling right now. Like it feels like there's bugs under my fucking skin. I don't know why this stuff specifically, because it feels like I'm in a dream, and I don't like that feeling, right? And so I tried another similar search, and at this point, we're not even getting to art style, right? So I'm like, okay, we should just abandon the anime manga stuff. I feel like it'd be just as good if we generated a realistic person that happened to look like Chizuru. So at this point, I just kind of got frustrated. I was like, does this thing know what a rental girlfriend is? I said, the best rental girlfriend ever. And the pictures were just not. She's in a party. I don't know. Okay. So I wanted to know if the neural network even knew who Chizuru was. So I said, Naruto on a date with Chizuru. And it sort of knows who Naruto is, right? Naruto is, again, the DeviantArt 2012 style, right? Naruto is a guy with spiky hair, but it has no idea who Chizuru is. So I wanted to see, like, okay, who else does it know? So I said, Naruto on a lunch date with Mickey Mouse while Margaret Thatcher spies on them from the table over, right? which sort of overloaded the thing. Like, bottom left is just not the prompt. Top right is Naruto and Mickey, but Mickey is a painting, so he's like on a date with like a drawing, and that's not like Margaret Thatcher. Margaret Thatcher has like Mickey Mouse ears in the bottom right, so that's fun. And then I said, okay, Mizuhara Chizuru, and I got these mountains. So yeah, it does not know who she is whatsoever. So I was like, okay, it doesn't know what a waifu is. And yes, it does, actually. So I was like, okay, maybe I can get it to generate a waifu. And no, that was not the play. That was not the play. But it did generate the first non-white woman. And I was pretty happy about that. Right? So I was like, okay, how about on a date with perfect waifu? And it told me that my request was too sexual to complete, which took me the fuck out, for sure. That took me the fuck out. So I was like, okay, we need to abandon that right quick. They trusted me. They trusted me with this technology, right?
So I was like, okay, on a date with like an actress, right? And then we got this, we got more horror, another woman of color, which is good. That's closer, that's better. And then just like this woman here with like three legs and Jesus Christ. Okay. And I said, okay, tall, beautiful, aspiring actress. And all, none of these women have faces. So I said, tall, beautiful, aspiring actress with dark hair on a date. And the girl in the top left sort of looks like her, but she's just like white, right? And it's like, okay, we can work with this. We can work with this. So I specified Japanese. And it was pretty good. It was not bad. Like, we got this chick here. Her hands are abomination beyond human comprehension. So I was like, okay, maybe I should just like regenerate it. And we got the bottom left, right? I was like, that's pretty good. So we iterate on the bottom left, and this is what I came up with, right? Oh yeah, I added in a braid on her hair, right? And this is what we came up with. So yeah, we have. I think this is the most Chizuru-looking girl that Dolly 2 will ever produce. And, you know, just a short drawing session later, there we go. Chizuru, Mizuhara Chizuru, as generated by a neural network with some help from a human being that somewhat knows what he's doing. Okay, bye.